the rope you, John 3:16. Something changed in me. Red letters coming off the page, flood of my heart. Moses said, "Why are you complaining? Why are you putting the Lord to the test?" But the people were thirsty and continued to complain to Moses. They said, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt? To kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst?" Moses prayed earnestly to the Lord and said, "What can I do with these people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Take some of the leaders of Israel with you and go on ahead of the people. Take along the stick with which you struck the Nile. I will stand before you on a rock at Mount Sinai. Strike the rock, and water will come out of it for the people to drink. Moses did so in the presence of the leaders of Israel. The place was named Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites complained and put the Lord to the test when they asked, "Is the Lord with us or not?" Our second reading is Psalm 78, verses 1 through 4 and 12 through 16, God and His people. Listen, my people, to my teaching, and pay attention to what I have to say. I am going to use wise sayings and explain mysteries from the past, things we have heard and known, things that our ancestors told us. We will not keep them from our children. We will tell the next generation about the Lord's power and His great deeds and the wonderful things He has done. While their ancestors watched, God performed miracles in the plain of Zoan in the land of Egypt. He divided the sea and took them through it. He made the waters stand like walls. By day, He led them with a cloud, and all night long with a light of fire. He split open rocks in the desert and gave them water from the depths. He caused a stream to come out of a rock and made water flow like a river. Pardon me. Our last readings is from the book of Philippians, chapter 2, verses 1 through 13. Christ's humility and greatness. Your life in Christ makes you strong, and His love comforts you. You have fellowship with the Spirit, and you have kindness and compassion for one another. I urge you, then, to make me completely happy by having the same thoughts, sharing the same love, and being one in soul and mind. Don't do anything from selfish ambition or from a cheap desire to boast, but be humble toward one another, always considering others better than yourselves. And look out for one another's interests, not just for your own. The attitude you should have is the one that Christ Jesus had. He always had the nature of God, but He did not think that by force He should try to remain equal with God. Instead of this, of His own free will, He gave up all He had and took the nature of a servant. He became like a human being and appeared in human likeness. He was humble and walked the path of obedience all the way to death, His death on the cross. For this reason, God raised Him to the highest place above, and gave Him the name that is greater than any other name. And so, in honor of the name of Jesus, all beings in heaven, on earth, and in the world below will fall on their knees, and all will openly proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So then, my dear friends, as you always obeyed me when I was with you, it is even more important that you obey me now while I am away from you. Keep on working with fear and trembling to complete your salvation, because God is always at work in you to make you willing and able to obey His own purpose. The words of Holy Scripture.
Our final reading this morning is from Matthew 21, verses 23 to 32. The question about Jesus' authority. Jesus came back to the temple, and as He taught, the chief priests and elders came to Him and asked, "What right do you have to do these things? Who gave you such right?" Jesus answered to them, "I will ask you just one question, and if you give me an answer, I will tell you what right I have to do these things. Where did John's right to baptize come from? Was it from God or from human beings? And of course, they started arguing among themselves. What shall we say? If we answer from God, he will say to us, why then did you not believe John? But if we say from human beings, we are afraid of what the people might do, because they are all convinced that John was a prophet. So they answered him, we don't know. And he said to them, neither will I tell you then by what right I do these things. And then the parable of the two sons. There was once a man who had two sons. He went to the older one and said, son, go and work in the vineyard today. I don't want to, he answered. But later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. Yes, sir, he said, but he didn't go. Which of these two did what the father wanted? The older one, they answered. So Jesus said to them, I'll tell you, the tax collectors and prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John the Baptist came to show you the right path to take, and you would not believe him. But the tax collectors and prostitutes believed him. Even when you saw this, you did not later change your minds and believe him. First of all, I want you to know that I had 3 pages of this sermon written and it disappeared. So I had to start all over, and I hope it's good. We were told in Exodus about the people always wanting and complaining. Of course, their main problem was water, and God came through using Moses. In Psalm, we listened to the people being reminded of all that God had done for them. Then in Philippians, we are told that we all have a fellowship with the Holy Spirit and to love everyone. We are told to put others before ourselves, to love one another, and that we should always be faithful and obey Jesus' example. Then in Matthew, we are told that Jesus does have the authority and the right to teach them. We also have the parable of the two sons. Occasionally, I watch videos where people are telling you how to do one thing or another. Some demonstrate cooking, others tell you how to live, and what you should be doing. These are not my favorite, and I often wonder what credentials or backgrounds qualified the speaker to tell us how to live our lives. My attitude toward these videos tends to be negative, and I wonder what makes them think we should follow their advice. That appears to be the same way that religious leaders react to the teachings of Jesus. They directly question his authority. Of course, at this point in the gospel, Jesus has been ministering and teaching for quite some time. They have heard his teachings before, and it's worth noting that they never questioned the content of the teaching, just the person conveying it. Their objection, however, is to discredit him. But they don't have an argument against the claims that Jesus makes that are deeply rooted in the law of the prophets. He knows the sacred text better than they do for a reason. Those who follow him know he is correct, but those who are against him feel otherwise. Jesus and his teachings threaten them. They question his authority because his message opposes theirs. The priests and the elders have lost their way, forgetting that the role of religious leaders is to encourage the faithful functionings of the community, not to hold power over them, but to share power with those entrusted to their care. Jesus cuts through their rules and barriers, regulations and boundaries, in order to be with those seeking an encounter with the Holy One. There's no need for a middleman, especially when Jesus comes to share his message. The hostility towards Jesus rises as Matthew's gospel moves into its final phase. This leads to the conclusion that the earthly ministry of Jesus will usher in a new era. Naturally, the conflict between Jesus and the religious rulers heightens. There is no real conflict, however, between Jesus and the Jewish people. He and his earliest and closest followers faithfully practiced the faith. In the early church, it was common for followers of Jesus to keep Sabbath on one day and to gather for Christian worship and fellowship on the next. It is important to remember this reality, as this passage, among others, has been used to diminish the Jewish people and to justify violence against them. Not only is that harmful, it's not faithful to the good news of Jesus. These interpretations of Christian scripture constitute a long, shameful, and tragic tradition of anti-Jewish attitude and practices among Christian groups that should not be forgotten, but should never be replicated. Such readings pose an ongoing challenge to gospel readers. God has never abandoned Israel. God has never revoked the covenant with his people. Has God withdrawn love and grace once and for all? It is both tragic, given the history of the interpretation, and hopeful for a different future. There seems to be a troubling change in some commentaries where they work out interpretations of these two parables. They take them to mean that the church now over Israel in God's work and salvation. In the parable, the two sons, they associate the disobedient son with Israel and the obedient son with the church. It is unlikely that Matthew or his mostly Jewish community would have promoted this idea. They wouldn't be setting Jew against Gentile in their shared community of faith. That would not happen. Matthew maintains a privileged place for Israel in God's salvation, and he opens all nations to God's blessing. He includes all nations as part of the traditional Jewish hope. There is much more reason to believe Matthew is associating Israel with the vineyard. It is a change in the leaders that is needed, replacing the unfaithful with faithful leaders. Jesus responds to the leader's questions with his own. He often starts with his own question. He guides them to a position of supporting his argument. Then the leaders recognize the potential trap that they, as they talk with each other and make like they have no clue. As they claim not to know the answer, they expose the cowardice beneath the bravado. Bullies inevitably retreat when their attempt to dominate and destroy are met with resistance. Jesus is not playing their game, and we shouldn't either. He refuses to answer as they refuse to answer. The difference is, Jesus is up front, and although he knows the answer, he will not continue to engage on their terms when their actions reflect a lack of integrity. Ultimately, the leaders want Jesus to submit to their authority. In other words, they want to control him and his message. That's not the way of Jesus. They reject Jesus just as they rejected John the Baptist. This morning, we need to embrace Jesus and his teachings. That's the only way. I think we need to embrace our friends as well as our Lord. He did tell us to always put ourselves after others' needs. Can we do that today, in this world, in Atlanta? I think we can, even though it isn't the easy way to go. Amen.